Eukaryotes. That is the most important thing for you to remember. Irrespective of their nutrition, all the unicellular eukaryotes have been categorized together in protista. Now, the term protista was coined by Ernst Haeckel. Alright? Now, a very important point or a fact regarding kingdom protista is that because the kingdom protista consists of unicellular eukaryotes, so that's why this kingdom consists of the ancestors to all the multicellular forms or advanced form of life, that is fungi, plants and animals. So that's why this kingdom is going to show maximum diversity. It will possess certain of organisms like plants, some like fungi and some like animals. Okay, so in that case, maximum diversity as it consists of ancestors to fungi, plants and animals. Alright? Next. That's why this kingdom is also known as connecting link between primitive and advanced organisms. The primitive monerans and the advanced fungi, plants and animals. It's a link between the primitive monerans and advanced organisms. Alright? So these are the very important points that you need to remember regarding protista. Now let us discuss the general characteristics. Kingdom protista, the habitat, if we talk about, they are mostly aquatic. They are mostly aquatic, both freshwater and marine. Both freshwater and marine. Next, true nucleus and cell organelles are present because they are all eukaryotes. That's why they possess a true nucleus, that means nuclear membrane is going to be present, and the cell organelles are also present. That means ER, Golgi complex and ATS ribosome, all of that would be present. Now, as I have told you already, the kingdom shows maximum diversity. So in that case, in every form or in every type of mode, you will find a lot of diversity. Like if we talk about locomotion. Locomotion in protists can be of various types, like flagella. Flagellar protists are present. Now the flagella we have talked about in monera as well. In bacteria also flagella is present. But that flagella is different than the flagella present in the eukaryotes. Here, the flagella is made up of tubulin protein and shows 9+2 arrangement. Okay, it shows 9+2 arrangement of tubulin proteins, that is microtubules. Then there is cilia. Okay, one thing, the flagella protist, example if you ask me, example will be dinoflagellate. Now even in case of cilia, the cilia has the same 9+2 arrangement of tubulin proteins. An example can be paramecium. Alright? Then, next. Pseudopodia. Pseudopodia, all of you know, is the false feet or the blunt extension of the protoplasm, which is going to be present in amoeba. Then, mucilage propulsion. Here, the cell would secrete thick mucilage in the direction opposite to the direction of movement. So, this is very common in diatoms. So many different types of locomotion. Likewise, now if we take into consideration the nutrition, again you will find nutrition can be of many types, like holophytic. Holophytic nutrition means photosynthetic nutrition or autotrophic mode of nutrition. That would be of course present in photosynthetic protist. Example will be dinoflagellates, diatoms, etc. Alright, next, holozoic. The holozoic mode of nutrition means where the organism will ingest the food, digest and assimilate from other plants or animals. Now this will be, the ideal example would be amoeba. Then saprotrophic. Alright, that would be seen in slime molds. Slime molds. That means they will feed upon dead and decayed particles. Next can be parasitic. Parasitic mode, all of you know here. The organism would remain inside a host and it would take nourishment from it while causing diseases. Example would be Plasmodium, the malarial parasite. All of these examples are important examples or important members of Kingdom Protista. Keep the examples in mind. Biological classification chapter is all about knowing examples. If you don't remember examples, in that case, attempting the questions would become a problem. And finally, is a very unique mode of nutrition that's called mixotrophic. Mixotrophic nutrition is very unique. Here, an organism would be autotrophic in the presence of light, but it would be heterotrophic in the absence of light. And such unique mode can be seen in Euglena. So that's why Euglena, even today, is referred as a connecting link between plants and animals due to its mixotrophic nutrition. Alright, now let's see the reproduction. The reproduction in the protist can be of two types, that is asexual and sexual. First, talking about asexual mode, Asexual mode again shows a lot of variations, like it can be binary fission. The cell would divide and give rise to two daughter cells. Example would be diatoms. Then multiple fission. Multiple fission is very common in the malarial parasite Plasmodium. Then sporulation. Sporulation or spore formation, very common in the slime molds. Then there is a unique mode of asexual reproduction that's called plasmotomy. So plasmotomy is a very unique mode. Here the parental cell is already multinucleate, so when the progenies are formed, they would simply undergo cytokinesis, not karyokinesis. Okay, this is very common in Opalina. Now for sexual reproduction, sexual reproduction consists of two events, syngamy and meiosis. Syngamy means gametic fusion, and gametic fusion would of course give rise to a diploid zygote, and the zygote would then eventually develop and give rise to the organism, but then meiosis will again further take place to give rise to gametes. Alright, so syngamy and meiosis, these are the two events that would decide upon the sexual reproduction. Alright, and under syngamy again you know that it can be of three types: isogamy, anisogamy and eugamy. Right, so this entire thing forms the general characteristics of the kingdom Protista. Fine, now let me tell you something very very important regarding the life cycle pattern of kingdom Protista. See, the life cycle of kingdom Protista consists of two main patterns. One is zygotic meiosis, another is gametic meiosis. Zygotic meiosis would occur in those members which are haploid. So the parental body here is haploid, and the haploid cells would then give rise to gametes by mitosis. They will not undergo meiosis for formation of gametes. So once the gametes are formed, the gametes will undergo syngamy or fusion, giving rise to a diploid zygote. The zygote would then immediately undergo meiosis to give rise to the haploid state again. Okay, so that's why the haploid members will show zygotic meiosis in their life cycle pattern. Understood? Whereas gametic meiosis, here the members would be diploid. So because they are diploid, they will produce gametes by meiosis. That's when we call it as gametic meiosis. Eventually the gametes will fuse together and they will restore the diploid state again. Alright? Let me give you a few examples, like Gymnodinium. Okay, Gymnodinium is a dinoflagellate and it shows zygotic meiosis. So its life cycle pattern is called haplontic. Okay, whereas most diatoms, most diatoms will show gametic meiosis because they are diploid, and that's why their life cycle pattern will be diplontic. Alright, so according to whether the life cycle shows zygotic meiosis or gametic meiosis, life cycle patterns can be haplontic or else If it shows gametic meiosis, then diplomatic. Alright? So that is regarding the general characteristics. Next, we'll discuss about types of protist. So now, regarding the types of protist, first of all, protist can be of three types. Autotrophic, consumer decomposer protist, and protozoans. As I've told you already that in this kingdom there will be some members like fungi, some like plants, and some like animals. So this is how we have divided them. Here we'll have autotrophic plant-like members. This will be saprotrophic like fungi, and this will be heterotrophic like animals. Okay, so see here, under autotrophic we have dinoflagellates, diatoms, and euglenoids. Alright, under consumer decomposer protist we have acellular, slime molds, and cellular slime molds, and under protozoans we have four types according to their locomotion: zooflagellates, ciliates, sarcodines, and sporozoans. Before we discuss the types in details, it is very important that you remember this chart. You have to first remember which are the types and they are in which categories. Only then understanding and studying each of them in details would become easier. Okay, so we'll be starting with autotrophic protist and dinoflagellates, but in the next class. Till then, you memorize the entire chart and everything related